به كما يحبه ويرضاه. اللهم صل على محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وسلم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. ربنا يسر ولا تعسر وتمم بالخير وبك نستعين يا فتاح. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. First of all, we give our praise and our thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the favors and bounties Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed on us. And we send salat and salam on his last and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As we continue with the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in our last session we completed everything that took place in the 5th year after Hijrah. So inshallah, this session will start the 6th year after Hijrah, which means this is the 6th year the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has stationed as resident in Medina. This year, the 6th year after Hijrah, a lot of the incidents were expeditions. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent out a lot of expeditions, sent out different armies to different tribes for different reasons. So most of the year, this was known as the year of expeditions because of the amount that was sent out in this year. It was only till the second to last month of the year, which was in Dhul-Qa'dah, that an incident of Hudaybiyah took place, which is known as Umratul Hudaybiyah. But before that, from Muharram right down until Dhul-Qa'dah, was one expedition after the other. Some of them, very few, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he participated in, and as we mentioned, those that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam participated in, they are called ghazwa, whereas many of them were sariyas, which he did not participate, but he just sent out an army, a few of the companions, and he put someone in charge, and they went out to deal with their enemies. So the first expedition in the year 6 AH took place on the 10th of Muharram. This is known as the expedition of Muhammad bin Maslama. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him to a place called Kurta, and he sent him with 30 other companions as fighters to go with him, to accompany him to this place called Kurta. When they reached there, they intercepted the enemies at Kurta, and they were very successful. They killed 10 of the enemies were killed, 10 of the unbelievers were killed. And as for the spoils of war from that expedition, they got 150 camels, 3,000 goats, and they returned to Medina on the 29th of Muharram. So this is the first month. When they reached into Medina, they give the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam 1/5 of the spoils of war, and the remaining was distributed amongst the Muhajir. But on their way back to come to Medina, they caught hold of an unbeliever by the name of Thumama bin Uthal al-Hanafi. So on their way going back, they found him, so they took him along with them in Medina. When they reached Medina and they brought him in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, tie him up in the masjid. See, he was tied up. He's a captive because he was taken when they went to fight in that expedition. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to tie him up in the masjid, leave him in the masjid. And this was a tactic of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because when these individuals see the Muslims praying, normally in the masjid, Muslims behave to their best more than when they're at home. So when they are tied up in the masjid and they are seeing that Muslims are coming 5 times a day, they are praying to Allah, they are putting their heads on the ground and they're making sajda, this is something that could change their hearts. As well as being in the masjid, they'll be able to listen to Quran, because when the salat is being done, they have, for example, a Maghrib Salat, they'll be listening to Quranic recitation. Isha, they'll be listening to Quranic recitation. So listening to these things is going to help him to change his heart and want to accept Islam. So this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he put him in the masjid, tie him up in the masjid. The first day had passed. One of the Salat, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was coming out to lead, and he passed him. He saw him tied up to the pillar. He asked him, Ma'indaka, what do you think about me? What are your thoughts about me? This man, he is a captive, he's tied to the pillar. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Indi ya Muhammad, I only have good thoughts of you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." He says, "In taqtul taqtulu dha dammin." If you are to kill me, you have the right to do that. If you are to kill me because I am a captive, you have the right to kill me if you want to kill me. But wa in tan'im tan'im ala shakir. But if you are kind to me, if you are to release me, then you will be doing kindness to someone who is very grateful. Which means I'm going to be very thankful and very grateful if you are to release me. And he says, but in kunta turidu al-mal, and if you want wealth, fasal tu'ti minhu ma sha, then ask me and I'm going to give you anything you want. This was his reply to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam remained silent and he went away. He went and lead the salat. And after the salat, he went straight back to his room, did not speak to him again for the remaining of the day. The next day, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out. Again, he asked him the same question. Ma indaka, what do you think about me? You have spent tied up to this pillar for an entire day. You have seen us praying. You are being fed food. Food has been given to you. What are your thoughts about me? Do you feel that I am a very bad man? Do you think that I am too strict? Tell me, what do you think about me? And at this time, instead of saying all that which he said the day before, he says, "In tan'im tan'im ala shakir." If you are kind to me, O Messenger of Allah, then I am going to be very grateful to you. That is all he said the second day. Prophet again remained quiet and he went away. On the third day, he came back and he asked Thumama bin Uthal. He asked him again, "Ma indaka, what do you think about me?" And instead, he already answered the first day, he answered the second day. He realized that he's not getting any response really from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "I already answered 2 days. The answers I give you the 2 days is the same answers I have. I have no other answers besides those 2 days." And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the companions, "Release him, untie him, let him go. He's free to go." This individual, Thumama bin Uthal, he was happy, he's released. He went outside of the masjid, went by a date palm, performed ghusl, and entered back the masjid. And he recited a kalima, "La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah." He became a Muslim. This was as a result of the treatment he got from the companions. Even though he was tied in a masjid, he saw the Muslims, the behavior of the Muslims. He was able to listen to the Quranic recitation. He came back and he recited a kalima. And then he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Before, your face used to be the most hated face I wanted to see. But today your face is the most loved face in my sight." So your religion used to be the most hated thing I could think about. But today your religion, the religion of Islam, is the best. He says, the city of Medina, I never wanted to step foot in this city. I was brought here. I didn't even want to come to Medina. How much I hated Medina because of your presence in Medina. But today, the city of Medina is the most beloved to me. This was Thumama bin Uthal. And then he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "When they caught me, I was on my way to perform Umrah." He was an unbeliever, but he was heading to Makkah to perform the Umrah. So he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Should I continue on my journey to perform the Umrah or not?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Yes, continue. You made intention to go perform the Umrah, then continue and perform the Umrah." So he left Medina and he went to Makkah. When he went to Makkah, now the unbelievers there, they surrounded him and they started to abuse him, that he has left the religion of his forefathers. How could he accept Islam? Because they knew him. How could he do that? And he said to them, "I'm never going to leave the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I'm never going to return back to shirk ever again. I'm never going to worship these idols again." And he said to them that normally they would normally import grains from Yamama. He was originally from Yamama, Thumama. So he said to them, "I'm going to stop the imports of grains from Yamama. I'm not going to send any again to Makkah. The only way I'm going to continue to send that is if you write to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and ask him to write to me. Only then I'm going to continue to send you grains in Makkah." At the beginning, they didn't take it on, but when he went back to Yamama, he stopped everything from coming to Makkah, all the grains. And as their food supply started to decrease, they realized that they need this supply from Yamama. So the unbelievers had no other choice but to write a letter to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they pleaded to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to write to Thumama radiallahu ta'ala anhu and ask him to continue to sell us these grains. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wrote to Thumama. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, we know Yamama was one of the places that a lot of people apostate, because there is where Musaylam al-Kadhab was from. So a lot of people started to accept Musaylam al-Kadhab. Thumama, who was there, was trying to get the people to come back to the pure Islam. So much so he kept on giving them dawah until 3,000 of them came back to Islam. But when he realized that the remaining of them are not going to come back, he left and he went and joined up with Ala bin Hadrami radiallahu ta'ala anhu, another companion, and he stayed with them on that side. So this was the first expedition. The second expedition was known as the expedition of Banu Lihyan. During one of our sessions, we talked about Raji, the incident of Raji when 10 of the companions were killed. You had Khubayb radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Asim bin Thabit, they were killed. And as a form of avenging their death, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he personally went with 200 of the companions. This happened on the 1st of Rabi al-Awwal, the 6th year after Hijrah. When the Banu Lihyan, they heard that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is coming, all of them fled, all of them went away. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he reached there was no one there again. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stayed there for 2 days, there were no fighting. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent out Abu Bakr to search to see if they are anywhere around. He couldn't see anyone anywhere. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, let us go back to Medina. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam head back to Medina, and whilst on his journey back to Medina, he was reciting his dua, A'ibuna ta'ibuna abiduna li rabbina hamidun, a'udhu billahi min wa'tha'i safar wa kabatil munqalib wa su'ul mundhir fil ahli wal mal, which means A'ibuna, I am returning. A'ibuna, I am returning. Ta'ibun, repenting to you, O Allah. A'bidun, worshipping you, li Rabbina hamidun, to our Lord belongs all praise. I seek refuge in Allah from the difficulty, min wa'tha'i safar, which means from the difficulties of the journey. Wakabatil munqalib, and from the distress of returning. Wasu al mundir, and the unpleasant sight regarding our wealth and our family. So he went back into Medina. Then we had the third expedition. This was in Rabi al Awwal as well, 6 AH. This is known as the expedition of the Qarad. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent one of his companions. It is mentioned that the Qarad was a place where they used to water or used to keep the animals because of a well there. A watering spring was there. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had 40 of his camels there. And Uyayna bin Hisan and 40 horsemen came there, and they attacked those who were there. Amongst the people who were at that spring was Abu Zaus radiallahu ta'ala anhu's son. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had put him to guard the camel, and his mother was there, which is Abu Zar's wife was there. The two of them was watching the camel. When they came to raid, they killed Abu Zar's radiallahu ta'ala anhu's son, and they kidnapped his wife and took her away and took all the camels. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was another individual by the name of Salama bin Aqwa. When he heard what happened with the camels and with Abu Zar's son, he climbed up onto a hill. He was a very good archer. He climbed up onto a hill and said, Ya Sabaha. This is a term they normally use to alert, like danger. We need to act now. Ya Sabaha. He said that 3 times, and then he didn't wait on anyone. He started to follow the enemies by himself until he reached the place where they were hiding out. And he started to shoot arrows at them. And he was saying, Ana ibn al-Aqwa, I am the son of Aqwa, wal yawma yawma rada'a. Today is the day we're going to see who drank more milk from their mother. Whilst he was shooting arrows at them. And he shot so many arrows, and they shot back arrows as well. But they eventually started to flee, and they left the camels there because they couldn't go away with the camels. So he was able to get back all the camels, and he also got taught to Yemeni sheets. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mustered 700 men to come and try to get back the camel. He didn't know that the camel was already taken back by Salama bin Aqwa. Anyways, he also reached up to the enemies with his 70 men, and they had a fight. And most of them escaped. Only a few of them were killed. They have two of the unbelievers were killed, while one Muslim were martyred at that point. And when the rest of them flee, Salama bin Aqwa was still running after them. He didn't want to let anyone. He went and he saw where they went to hide. So he came back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I know their exact location. I know where they are hiding out. Send 100 companions with me and we'll finish all of them. Just send them with me. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, Ya Ibn al-Aqwa, O Ibn al-Aqwa, Malakta Fazja. If Allah was to ever give you power, if Allah was to ever give you authority, be affectionate, be loving. They have already run away already. That is enough. You already got back the camels. Let us just go to Medina. Forget about them. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left them. They went away. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he remained there for 5 days. And during that period, he performed Salat al-Khawf because he did not know if they were going to come and attack whilst they are praying their Salat. Then we had the fourth expedition. This expedition is known as the expedition of Ukasha bin Mihsan. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him to Ghamar, a place called Ghamar, in Rabi al-Awwal 6 AH. And he sent 40 men with Ukasha bin Mihsan. When they reached to Ghamar, there were no sign of anyone. There were no sign of any individuals there. There were no sign of any animals. So Ukasha bin Mihsan, he sent Shaj'a bin Wahab, another companion, to search the area to see if he sees anyone. He didn't see anyone also. But when he was coming back, he saw one man hiding, one unbeliever hiding. So he brought him back to the camp and decided to interrogate him. And he ended up speaking and told them the exact location of all the animals and so forth that they are hiding, because they knew that the Muslims were coming. So most of the people, they flee, but they hid their camels and their goats and so forth at certain spots. So he went in and they were able to get 200 camels. So the Muslims, they took the 200 camels and they returned back to Medina with the 200 camels. Then there was the fifth expedition, which occurred in Rabi al-Akhir, 6 AH. This is known as the expedition of Muhammad bin Maslama to Dhul Qassa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent 10 men with the leader of Muhammad bin Maslama being the Amir over them. He sent them to Dhul Qassa to confront two of the tribes that were deceptive. One of them were the Banu Tha'laba and the Banu Uwal. So the companions, when they reached to the area where the unbelievers were, which is at Dhul Qassa, they were very, very tired. So they reached in the night, they were tired, they said, you know what, we're going to sleep. And in the morning, we're going to start to deal with our preparations for fighting. So they went and they slept, whilst the unbelievers, they were hiding in the mountain. So when they saw the Muslims have reached and the Muslims are sleeping, 100 of the unbelievers came out and they attacked the Muslims in their sleep and they killed all of them. All of the Muslims, they thought they killed Muhammad bin Maslama. They injured him and they put a spear through him and they thought he was dead, but he wasn't dead as yet. And a passerby saw that he was alive and a passerby took him back to Medina. And he informed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of what happened with them. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard that, the Prophet was very angry. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was angry. All the companions that he sent, they were killed except Muhammad bin Maslama. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent another expedition, which is the sixth expedition to the same Dhul-Qasa, now under the leadership of Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And he sent him with 40 men, and they launched an attack at Dhul-Qasa where the people were, and they were able to get a lot of livestock, and they killed many of the unbelievers, and a lot of the unbelievers as well fled because they were not able to defeat the Muslims. Then we have the seventh expedition. So far, six expeditions from Muharram until Rabi al-Akhir. And then the seventh, another expedition happening again in Rabi al-Akhir. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent a few of the companions with Zayd bin Harisa radiallahu ta'ala anhu to a place called Jamum. When Zayd bin Harisa, he went there to fight the Banu Sulaim, Jamum is just 4 miles away from Medina. So this was a very quick expedition. He went there, and in 2 days' time, he returned. So he went there, the enemies, most of them fled, and he was able to get some camels and some goats, as well as some captives, and bring it back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then in Jamad al-Ula, there was the expedition of Is, which is the seventh expedition so far in the year. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard that one of the trade caravan was passing by a place called Is. So the caravan belonging to the Quraysh is passing by this place called Is. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent out 170 companions under the commander of Zayd bin Harisa radhiyallahu anhu. Is is 4 days from Medina, a journey of 4 days from Medina. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent them out. The Muslims were able to capture the goods, and most of the people, they were able to get a few captives as well, and some of them were able to escape. In this incident, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's son-in-law was taken a captive, Abu al-As. And when he was taken back to Medina, and his wife Zainab, which is the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be lenient with him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed him to go. He went back to Medina, gave all the goods, and then he came back and he accepted Islam. We dealt with this whilst we were talking about the Battle of Badr, because he was also captured in the Battle of Badr, and he was released. But under this incident, he was captured for a second time, and then he came and he accepted Islam. Then there was the ninth expedition, which occurred in Jamad al-Akhir again, 68. This one is known as the expedition of Tarif. Tarif is a spring which was 36 miles from Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent the companions there to punish the Banu Thalaba tribe. There were 15 men that were sent out under the leadership of Zayd bin Haritha. When they reached, the enemies fled again. The Muslims were able to seize some camels and some goods, and they returned back to Medina. Then Jamad al-Akhir again, 68. Another expedition called the expedition of Hamsa. The expedition of Hasma. Dihya al-Kalbi, one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sent him a letter to the king of Rome, the emperor of Rome. So he sent this letter with Dihya al-Kalbi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he went to Rome, give the letter to the emperor, and the emperor now sent back a reply to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he gave them a lot of gifts to bring back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, expensive gifts back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some of the unbelievers from the tribe of Juzam, they heard that this man is passing by with a lot of expensive goods, expensive gifts from the emperor of Rome. So they went and they attacked him. They attacked this one companion and they took away all the valuable and expensive gifts that were given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the emperor. There was one companion there from that tribe of Juzam. His name was Rifa' bin Zaid. When he heard what they did to Dihya al-Kalbi, he took a few others of his friends and he went and retrieved all the gifts and he gave it back to Dihya al-Kalbi.
And Dihya al-Kalbi radiallahu anhu, he returned to Medina. When he informed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of what took place, of them attacking him and taking away all the items, even though he got it back, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not take that lightly. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he ordered 500 companions under the leadership of Zayd bin Haritha to go and attack them. And they would travel in the night and they would hide during the day. So the Banu Juzam, they did not even know an army was coming to attack them. It was done secretly. So when they reached, they give the surprise attack to them. So much so that they were able to capture 500 women and children as captives. They got 500 camels and 1,000 goats. And it so happened because some of them were Muslim, because Rifa' bin Zayd was Muslim and some of his family members were Muslim. When they took all the captives, some of the Muslims were also included. And Rifa' bin Zayd radiallahu anhu, who went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him, "You have mistakenly taken some of the Muslims as captive and taken their goods as well." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam immediately give the command that they should be released, as well as every single thing was given back to them. That is the Muslims. So this was the expedition of Hasma. Then in Rajab, the month of Rajab, 68, another expedition went out, which is known as Wadi al-Qurra, the expedition of Wadi al-Qurra. Zayd bin Harisa again being the leader of this army that is going out. This was to punish the Banu Fazara tribe. But when they went there, the Banu Fazara tribe fought back. And because of the fighting that took place, a lot of Muslims were martyred in this expedition. And even Zayd bin Harisa, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was also injured in this battle. And then we have the last expedition that we're going to do tonight. There are a few more before we actually reach Dhul-Qa'dah, but there's one by the name of the expedition of Dawmat al-Jandal, which took place in the month of Sha'ban, 68. 10 companions were sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then a young Ansari came and he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ayyul mu'minina afdal?" He asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Which believer is considered to be the best?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Ahsanuhum akhlaqan." The best are those who have the best character. You have the best character, then you are the best of the believers. And then he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ayyul mu'minina aqyas?" Which of the believers are considered to be the most intelligent? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Aktharuhum lil mawti dhikran." Those who remember death a lot. Those who remember death a lot is the most intelligent. وَأَكْثَرَهُمْ إِسْتِعْدَادًا لَهُ قَبْلَ أَن يَنْزُلُوا بِهِ. And those who prepare for death. Not only remember death, but those who prepare for death before death comes to them. And then he says, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمَ الْأَقْيَاسِ. Those who are doing that, remembering and preparing for death, he says, those are the intelligent one of my ummah. And after he answered this Ansari man, he addressed his other companions who were there. And he said to them, "There are 5 deadly practices. There are 5 deadly practices that when it is done, Allah sent his adab in different ways because of those actions." He says, one is whenever a nation becomes immodest and shameful. Whenever a nation and a country starts to become immodest, start to become shameful, do not care how they dress, do not care how they behave. It says when a nation becomes like that, Allah sends a lot of diseases to that nation. Allah sends a lot of plague and Allah sends a lot of disease. It says the second, whenever a nation is involved in cheating and robbing, and they're involved in a lot of fraud, he says whenever that is happening, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a drought. Allah sends calamity on them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a cruel ruler over them. Because of them wanting to rob one another, cheat one another, Allah now puts a ruler that is going to treat them very badly. And he says the third is a nation who refrains from paying their zakat. Whenever a nation do not want to pay any zakat, Allah withholds the rain from them. And then he says that the fourth is a nation that betrays the trust of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the foreign enemies to overpower them. Because of them betraying the trust of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah sends the enemies to overpower them and now take away their possessions. And lastly, the fifth, he says, whenever the leaders and the rulers are judging against Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah will cause the people to be disunited. So he says, these are five things that we need to stay away from. And after that, he went to Abdurrahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhum, and he said to him, tomorrow, either today or tomorrow, I am going to send you out on a mission. So Abdurrahman bin Auf heard that, and he was waiting to know when he's going to really go out. And in the morning, soon after Fajr, he called Abdurrahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he said, I want to send you to Dawmat al-Jandal. And he took an amama, a turban. He put it on Abdurrahman bin Auf radiallahu anhu's head, and he wrapped it by himself on him as a form of barakah. And he left the tail of the amama, he left the length of four fingers. And he said to him, whenever you're wrapping your amama, you should wrap it like this. With the tail, the piece that you leave protruding at the back should be at least four fingers length. This is the length that should be protruding. And then he told Bilal radiallahu anhu, come and bring the flag for him. He gave him the flag. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then sent him off with 700 companions to Dawmat al-Jandal. And he said to him, when you go, you only fight those who rebel against you. He just don't go and fight. As soon as you reach there, don't go and fight. He says, don't be treacherous to the people there. Don't be deceptive to the people. And don't kill any children. And then he says, I'm sending you to Dawmat al-Jandal. If the tribe of Dawmat al-Jandal accepts Islam, says, don't hesitate to marry the daughter of the leader. If the tribe accepts Islam, he's given the command to Abdurrahman bin Auf, don't hesitate to go and get married to the daughter of the leader of Dawmat al-Jandal. So they went and they stayed there for 3 days, giving dawah every single day, giving dawah to see if they're going to accept Islam or not. And on the third day, the leader came and accepted Islam. His name was Asbagh bin Amr. He was a Christian. He came and he said, "What? I want to be a Muslim." And he accepted Islam. And when he accepted Islam, his whole tribe accepted Islam, every single one of them. And then when they all accepted Islam, Abdurrahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhu told the leader, which is Asbagh, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, if you accept Islam, I should marry your daughter. So he proposed to get married to the daughter of the chief, which is Asbagh radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and they got married. He got married to the daughter of the chief. Her name was Tudamir bint Asbagh. So he got married to Tudamir, and he brought her back to Medina. And from the two of them, one of the great tabi'in by the name of Abi Salama bin Abdurrahman was born. So this was the 12th expedition that took place, which reached till up to Sha'ban. So after Sha'ban, we only have a few more months, and then the Hudaybiyah took place, and that is all that really took place in the 6 years after Hijrah. So inshallah, in our next session, we'll try to finish off the rest of expedition, and we'll head into the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, inshallah. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanakallah wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.